Can you see by the dawn's early light what so proud?
You're listening to No Limits Radio Show on the Vets on Media Network.
Good morning. Good morning, Christina. I better turn your mic down a little bit. You're excited today.
Turn me up.
Happy Valentine's Day.
Happy Valentine's Day.
So last week we talked about all of the great gift ideas for Valentine's Day. Today, the day is actually here. It's Valentine's Day.
Woohoo.
are you a Valentine Scrooge?
No, but you know, my guy's like not even around. I mean, he's thousands of miles away. So for me, even though he's my Valentine, I'm very happy. Yeah, you know, it's not like I'm getting ready to go to dinner or anything, you know, spending the day with my Valentine.
Well, I kind of had a feeling that you might feel that way, which is why I got you a little something.
You did.
I did.
You're so sweet.
Ready, catch?
Oh, no, don't. Hell no, don't throw that.
Happy Valentine's Day.
Oh, thanks, sweetie.
You're welcome. All right. So last week I shared a little bit about how I felt about roses, and I shared the picture of my beautiful roses that I got. Michelle, how do you think I feel about roses?
I already know how you feel about roses, and you think they're the gift of death. So, well, I shouldn't say roses. I should say flowers in general.
Yes.
I'm not quite sure what you're going to do for your wedding because you feel like flowers are the gift of death, but I know it's different. That's decoration. But as a present, you do not like flowers because they just die.
Exactly. So I got the most, probably the... I got roses today that are probably the most expensive roses that I have ever received. Do you know what makes them so expensive?
I don't know.
Okay, well, let me share with you what happened this morning. So I wake up, I roll over and see my lovely fiance getting up and scooting out, trying to leave before I wake up. And I think, oh, that's so sweet. He's going out to get me coffee. Maybe he got me like chocolate covered strawberries or something sweet like that. Oh, yay. I can't wait till he comes back in the room. I wait a little bit and he doesn't come back. He doesn't come back. And then my daughter, she's knocking on the door. She's like, are you going to drive me to work? Well, you could probably take Rob's car. No, Rob's not here. Huh. That's interesting. I have no idea where he went. I get a call from him a few minutes later. So I really messed up. What's the matter? Well, I went to get your roses and I locked my keys in the car. And my spare is in the car.
His spare key is in the car.
So, okay. He had to call a locksmith. Mm-hmm. Locksmith has to come out. So when you bundle in the cost of the roses and the locksmith, they were easily the most expensive roses I have ever received.
So was the window not rolled down a little bit to where you could have put something in there? And no.
He's shaking his head no.
And I'm just going to say, because I know for a fact that Christina, you catch a lot of grief about your blonde moments from your fiance, I'm sure, because I give them to you all the time. So I'm sure he does kind of the same
thing. No, I get them more from you than anyone else.
Yeah. Perfect. Well, it's a good thing it wasn't you that kept your spare key in the car, because that's pretty silly. No, there's no logical explanation at all to have a spare key in the car. That just is, there's nothing logical about that. Go ahead, step up to the mic. I'd like to hear you defend yourself on this one. Wait, I gotta unmute it. Hold on. Go ahead.
Really quickly, it was only gonna be a temporary thing, but our junk drawer in our kitchen, the drawer fell apart, so I had to kind of glue and staple it together. Uh-huh. So in the one place I knew I wouldn't lose it would be in my car, because things just go missing in our house all the time.
Right.
So in at one point that made sense to me.
Uh-huh.
But now
it kind of doesn't.
Not so much.
I understand. Because I could think of lots of safe places other than in the car, like my underwear drawer or the freezer or the dog bowl. I mean, there's just like hundreds of places I could think besides in the car.
You know what I love, though, is that, you know how when something happens and you always say, oh, we'll laugh about this one day. Well, one day came really quick for this story because I'm laughing already.
You're already laughing. I don't blame you.
And I have to say, I think that these roses will live on forever because of this story.
Yeah, they'll be dead by Wednesday.
No, the spirit of the roses are going to live on forever.
That might be true.
Yeah, but it was really cute because he was like, secretly, I think you really wanted roses. I was like, okay, let's have this conversation really clearly. No roses. Aww. I would have been happy with a coffee.
Well, Rob, let me give you an idea maybe for future ideas, since, you know, this Valentine's Day turned into a expensive one and you didn't have food or anything. You just have some roses that are going to die and a locksmith bill. But anyway, so let's start the WWW.
Okay, let's go into the WWW.
And I want to read this amazing article. As everyone knows, Huffington Post is my Bible when it comes to news. I think they're more honest than CBS, Fox, CNN, all of them. I just love Fox or Huffington Post. It's where I go. Anyway, this is a story about a romantic husband who has written his wife a love letter every day for over 3 decades. So this is out in New Jersey. Bill Bresnan, he's 74, told the Huffington Post, I give her a note or scribble on a napkin for her and send postcards. It started in the 80s. He just wrote a note to her. And then it turned into every single day he has written her a note. They have boxes and boxes of these notes. They've kept all of them. And they said they love to go through them because they know exactly like what they were doing and everything. Because he might say, tomorrow we'll be on the cruise. So they just kind of go through their life. So he has now, they have over 10,000 notes.
That's crazy.
It is. And I think it's awesome.
What I also liked about the story is that they never go to bed angry. They always, you know, they've never had a fight, which I find skeptic, but.
Well, there's a difference between a disagreement and a fight. I'm sure that they've had disagreements.
Okay.
But they're saying they haven't had a fight. Yes, his quote was, we've never gone to bed mad or without kissing. All issues and arguments ended at night. So they did have arguments. They just didn't have fights. It's one of the keys to a happy marriage. She looks forward to getting the notes every single day. He gives them to her right before they go to bed. And his advice for the younger generation is, he says, you'll see a young couple at a restaurant and they're just sticking their heads into devices instead of looking into each other's eyes. If you concentrate on each other and don't get distracted by all the other, by everything outside, you will be fine. It worked for us.
Aw, that's really good advice. As Rob's sitting over there on his device.
I thought it was sweet. Yeah. Well, there goes that idea. Let's think of another one. Maybe you should donate a kidney to somebody if you didn't have Christina. Did you see the story?
I did.
This is pretty cool, isn't it?
It's very cool. I kind of feel like you had love on the brain today when you were finding the these stories.
No, did I? Well, it's Valentine's Day.
Yeah, so no, I love it.
Just because I'm like, oh, it's Valentine's Day doesn't mean that everybody else in the world isn't saying, yay, it's Valentine's Day.
Sure.
So anyway, this is a story about a woman, Ashley McIntyre, who heard a story of a 25-year-old man, Danny Robinson, who had a kidney disease. This was on the radio show. He's 25 years old. He had a kidney disease, and no one in his family was a match. So she decided that she would see if she was a match to him. And turns out she was. So they went through the surgery. Everything turned out well. They started talking and communicating. They are now married and expecting their first child.
It's beautiful.
So isn't that cool?
Yeah, it's very beautiful. Would you ever give up your kidney, or would you give a kidney to a complete stranger?
It'd probably depend whether I was in a good mood that day or not.
Oh my gosh.
I don't know. I guess I've never thought about it. To someone I knew in a heartbeat, you know, it's apparently pretty easy, harder though for the person I think giving it up than right. the person receiving.
Right.
But you know, I don't know that it's like life threatening. So someone that I knew, absolutely, a complete stranger. I don't know. Does that make me a horrible person?
No.
Would you?
No, I want to say that I would. I mean, it's a major surgery.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I just don't know. Like if I heard on the radio, oh, there's this person with a kidney disease, that I would say, I think I should go get tested. I don't know that I would go that far. I don't know.
I guess since we've never sought it out, maybe we wouldn't. I guess we're horrible people.
Maybe if you said to me, or a friend or someone said to me, I know someone who needs a kidney, then maybe I would.
And if you heard the story about, you know, how they're 25 years old, they're so young, and then your heart was compelled. Okay, maybe I would. All right, I feel better about myself. Let's go on to the next one.
Can you sleep tonight?
I can. Okay.
Hey, there's some great news coming out of New York City.
Yeah?
Yep.
What's that?
They have gone 10 days without a murder.
10 whole days.
10 whole days. I read this and I was like, I guess we say congratulations. But like, this is a huge, this has been since 1963. This is like a record. 10 straight days without a murder.
That's really sad.
In New York City. The Sergeant Daniel Duty. Wow. That's a great last name. Of the New York City Police Department said everybody is behaving.
That's really sad though. I mean, could you imagine living somewhere where it's a mile marker, it's significant that you've gone 10 days without a murder?
It's very significant. But I guess last year overall, they had 363 murders. So it was down like 10% or something from the year before.
That is so sad and scary.
I know. So they said it has something to do with the weather, obviously, because when it's warm out, people tend to lose their temper.
I don't think it's just the weather, because look at how hot it is in Arizona and we don't have this issue. I think it's because they're also cramped in one space.
Do you?
I do.
I don't know what it is, but anyway, congratulations, New York City. You made it 10 days. I'm very happy for you.
Yay.
Now, of course, this was posted 2 days ago, so I'm assuming the streak is over. I think 10 days was their streak and we're beyond that now.
That's sad.
It is sad. But speaking of horrible things that happen and someone getting their justice. Did you read about Deanna Thompson?
I did.
This is an interesting, all of it is interesting to me.
I got to say, okay, tell them the headline.
Okay. So the headline is Deanna Thompson burns home of convicted child killer Jared Harrell.
Okay. So when you first read that headline, mm-hmm. it kind of seems very eye for an eye. And I had such mixed feelings about it.
Yeah.
But then as you proceed through the story,
yes. So this happened in Orange Park, Florida. Her daughter in October of 2009 was kidnapped, sexually assaulted, and strangled by Gerald Harrell. What happened was he pled guilty, and the house that he lived in that was owned by his mother at the time of the murder eventually went into foreclosure. The bank transferred the ownership to the foundation that she started. So one, I thought that was interesting that the bank gave her that home.
Sure.
I kind of thought that was weird. But anyway, the foundation donated the house to the Orange Park Fire Department so that it could set it ablaze to start training exercises. So they allowed her to actually start the fire.
Right. Which they'll use that house for training purposes.
Yes.
So once you read the rest of the story, it's like, okay.
It makes sense.
Yeah. Now it makes sense.
Yeah. And then once this is all done, because you know, they're going to use it for however long they use it for their training, and then they're going to be done with it. So yeah. She's, the foundation is looking at possibly cleaning up the land and using it for a playground.
Yeah.
So I think that's pretty cool.
And I'm sure it was very healing for her. Well, I don't know that it was healing, but maybe there was a healing component to it.
I don't know
that you ever have closure from that.
No.
But
yeah, I thought it was interesting. Good for that fire department to let her do it.
Yeah.
So do you have any barking dogs in your neighborhood?
Oh my gosh. Our neighbor right behind us has the worst barking dog.
Really?
Yes.
Is it like all day? Is it just at night or is it in the morning?
It's at all times of the day. Like I think there's two or three dogs back there and yeah, the dogs just start going nuts.
You know how I am about crazy lawsuits, and I kind of feel like this is a crazy lawsuit.
I agree.
However, Denise Norton has a dog that apparently barks, and her neighbor Woodrow Thompson filed a lawsuit. Here's why I think the lawsuit is crazy. Intentionally causing him profound emotional distress because of this dog. He claimed that the canine's howling and explosive barking was capable of reaching 128 decibels. So to put that in context for people, even though the Occupational Safety and Health Administration says that a person should not be exposed to a noise of over 115 decibels for longer than 15 minutes a day. However, if he really was barking that loud, it would be louder than an ambulance siren and just slightly softer than a jet engine at takeoff. Now, do you really think that dog is that loud?
I don't know, but the thing is, that factor is completely irrelevant.
You're right. So
because
so he sues her.
Right.
And she thinks it's a crazy lawsuit, just like me.
Right.
I think that she's founded in that.
Right.
But she ignores it, completely ignores it, and she doesn't even go to court. And because she doesn't go, he wins $500,000 by default. So yep. She's looking at like losing her house. I mean, everything, because she just didn't
go to court. And so now she's having to shell out a chunk of change to try to fight this. But the judge has already made a decision. So getting the judge to reverse their decision, good luck with that.
Yeah, because the sheriff already came, put the papers on the garage and a wall and everything, saying that they are putting the house up for sale.
But you know what I wonder? I wonder if the neighbor ever went to her and talk to her about it. Like before the lawsuit, did the neighbor ever go and say, hey, listen, I've got a real issue. Your dog is barking. I mean, given that we have this issue right in our backyard, I have to say 100% before I would file a complaint, I'm going to go over there and I'm going to talk to them. And I'm going to say, listen, we got to talk about this. You know, I'm not going to let it escalate to we're going to court. Without having a conversation. That's just crazy.
I know. And unfortunately, I don't know in this article, like if he had done that, but apparently if he did, she didn't make any changes to it. But like, I'm a dog owner and I'm very conscious of my dogs out back
right. Because
like I'm up very early. So I let my dogs out like 5 o'clock and they're outside, and all my dogs love to be outside except for my Great Dane, who the second she's done doing what she has to do outside, she comes to the back door and barks.
And you guys, I want to give you a picture of this. She's got like 10 dogs.
I don't have 10 dogs. I have 4 dogs.
They're all huge though. So it feels like 10 dogs.
I do have 4 big dogs. Well, one's a puppy. She's not big yet.
But she's rambunctious. So she's like 4 dogs right there.
She's the craziest dog ever. This morning, I'm walking down the hallway and she's running down the hallway to come grab me, you know, to jump up on me and say, hi, good morning.
Yeah.
And I wasn't quite ready for it. So I had my cup of coffee in my hand and my cell phone in the other hand. And she jumps up and the coffee goes flying up all over my cell phone. So my cell phone's now sticky and gross with coffee because I haven't cleaned it yet. So anyway, if you call and I don't answer, it's because my phone's sticky and I can't figure out how to do that. So anyway, I'm conscious of my dog's back. So, but this lady apparently isn't, because he is louder than an ambulance.
Well, and I guess the thing is, here's the thing, what could she do? I mean, I know that there's a surgery that they can perform on the dogs that makes the bark muffle.
Well, you can take out their voice box.
Yeah.
It doesn't muffle it. It takes out their voice box.
Is that it?
Take it out. Like they still have a little bit of the voice, but not very much. But that I think is the procedure. They take out the voice box.
Dogs are going to bark.
Yeah. But if you know, like maybe it's an outside dog. I don't know. But like, I don't allow my dogs to just stay out back if it's super early or late at night, if they're barking, because obviously they want in or they want something. They don't want to be out there. If it's a constant thing,
right?
You know, I mean, they might bark if a cat comes by or whatever, but if it's constant, then you probably should pay attention to your dog.
I think her comment, the last line, he's a lovely dog. Yeah. No one's saying he's not lovely. He just barks really loud.
He's just loud.
Yeah.
He's very, very loud. So anyway, another lawsuit. It's a waste of taxpayers'
money.
It'll
be interesting to see how that goes.
Yes, it will.
And if she just would have shown up, the judge likely would have dismissed it as a frivolous lawsuit.
Too. Yep. I think so too.
But or maybe recommended that she bring the dog inside or take the dog to obedience training or something like that. You know, there may have been some recommendation, but
isn't a dog owner.
Yeah. It'll be interesting to see what happens with that story. I really hope they don't lose their house. I mean, that's just unbelievable.
Well, but what it's saying, she's already lost that. She lost the case. Like she doesn't have a chance.
Oh, they're already moved out of the house now?
No, they're not moved out of the house, but she owes $500,000. So, you know, she has to come up with it somehow.
That's crazy.
So she's probably gonna have to sell her house.
That's crazy.
So anyway, that's it for the WWW.
Well, good job on the WWW. Hey, I love those love stories.
You love the love stories.
I love the love stories.
I know you do.
I do. All right. So we're going to go to a break.
We are.
And when we get back, we have the Colonel and the Clairvoyant. So don't go away. Our phone lines will be opening. So stay tuned. I'm Christina.
And I'm Michelle.
Would you like to own a thriving business and help employ local veterans? The Vetroplex Handyman Construction and Landscape Business is the opportunity you've been waiting for. The Vetroplex is your gateway to an affordable startup business with 0% financing for qualifying owners. By owning a Vetroplex franchise, you will be hiring veterans, providing them both income and opportunity, while at the same time providing your customers a way to say, thank you for your service to our nation's veterans. For more information, visit Vetroplex.org. Again, that's Vetroplex.org or call 928-284-2022.
You got some ears on, son.
Have you ever wanted to be a truck driver? If so, pay attention. If not, pay attention anyway. Southwest Truck Driver Training offers everything you need to get started. You can get hired before you begin training. They've got GI Bill approved training facilities, day, night, or weekend programs to fit your busy schedule. And if you have any questions, no sweat. They've got veteran supportive campuses with veterans on staff to serve you. And on top of that, they have lifetime job placement assistance. Put the pedal to the metal. Call Southwest Truck Driver Training today.
Everyone's going to need an attorney at some point in their life. I'm no different. Hey everyone, it's James from Vets On. Whether it was my last will and testament before deployment or my ongoing custody battle for my children during my divorce, I needed help. So I lawyered up. If you need help, I urge you to contact Capstrom Law Firm. Capstrom Law Firm in Springfield, Missouri services clients throughout the state in criminal law, personal injury, and family law. With over 13 years practicing law, Tom Capstrom understands both law and court procedures and how stressful they can be. Let Tom Capstrom Law Firm and his dedicated staff take the stress and worry out of a difficult situation by calling him today. We feel so strong about the work that Tom and his staff are doing that he'll be a monthly guest on the show. Tom is a veteran and a listener, for God's sake, so you know the guy is solid and will fight for you. Give Tom a call today by calling 417-864-0552. CapstromLaw.com. And don't forget to tell him that Vets On sent you.
The choice of a lawyer is an important decision and should not be based solely upon advertising.
If you or someone you know is looking for a new job or career, you need to visit the pros. National Career Fairs at ncfairs.com. National Career Fairs hosts over 300 career fairs a year nationwide. The events are free and give you the perfect chance to meet some of the top employers in your area face-to-face. To find the nearest career fair to you, visit ncfairs.com. Again, that's ncfairs.com. What are you waiting for?
You're listening to No Limits Radio Show on the Vets On Media Network.
Welcome back. All right. So as I said,
I love shocking Christina early on a Saturday morning.
You're such a brat.
I was playing the ID and I'm like, we're live. And she jumps over to think, welcome back. And I'm like, oh no, they're still doing the ID.
Okay. Some of my blonde moments you like create, you realize that, right?
No, I don't create anything. Okay. I say the news.
All right, so in studio, we have Colonel Ed Kronholm And we have Melinda Vail. We've got the Colonel and the Clairvoyant. We're going to learn a little bit more about what it means to be clairvoyant. We're going to open up our phone lines. So in the lower thirds, Michelle, do you have the... She's going to set it up so that it's got the phone number. Perfect. So we've got the phone number. So if you're watching on the feed, you can just call in, but don't call in yet. We're going to open phone lines in a few minutes. So, Colonel, tell us a little bit about your service in the Army.
Well, I served about 25 years in the Army. I was a ROTC graduate from the University of New Hampshire. I had a full Army scholarship, which paid all my expenses, everything except my room and board, basically. And so I was fortunate back then to graduate without any college debt like so many young people do today. So I got a really nice start from my Uncle Sam, if you will. And later on, perhaps, we'll talk about my... running the ROTC department at Arizona State University, and how the Army still gives out scholarships for deserving young people. For example, if you're a nurse or wanting to be a nurse or a doctor or a dentist and you have good grades, it's almost guaranteed that you can get a scholarship, not necessarily from the Army, but from the Air Force, the Navy, or many of the other services as well. And so from there, I went on to many varied assignments in infantry, transportation, and training during the course of my 25-year career, serving at various posts here in the United States and overseas. But oddly enough, all my overseas time was in the Pacific Theater. And as I was telling you earlier, I don't think I've ever met another career soldier who never served in Europe during his 25-year career, for example. So that, in a nutshell, is the a summary of my career.
So let's go back to when you first joined the Army. Mm-hmm. Was the motivation to go to school? Was the motivation, I want to serve my country? Was it a little bit of both?
It was a little bit of both. My brother had been an Army reservist, and I grew up in a family that had a modest income, and I needed a way to pay for school. Mm-hmm. So I went and applied to West Point and also for the Army scholarship. And I was fortunate enough to get accepted to West Point, but chose not to go. And people thought I was crazy, but I had gone down there to look at it, and it just didn't appeal to me that much, primarily because at the time, of course, all they had there were men. Now it's co-ed. But
so
also at the time, they were very heavily oriented toward engineering, and math was never a strong subject of mine, and I didn't really want to be an engineer. And to be honest, all that spit and polish really did not appeal to me. So I turned down the appointment to West Point, who everyone thought was crazy, said I was crazy to do that. I had not been notified that I'd also won the Army scholarship to the school of my choice, as long as it had an ROTC program. And so that's why I ended up going to the University of New Hampshire, basically. I never planned, honestly, to spend a career in the Army. It just worked out that way. Once I got in the Army, I found that it was really interesting. I liked the outdoor work. I liked working with a variety of people and traveling all over the United States and later the world. And it was just a fascinating career. But as I mentioned earlier also, I'm not sure, you know, the military services have changed a lot these days. My personal opinion is they're a lot more politically correct. There's not much room for mistakes, if you will. So I'm not sure I could survive 25 years in the Army these days, but who knows?
So what would you say to someone who is getting ready to graduate high school, considering going in the military? Would you encourage them to do that?
Yes and no. And what I mean by that is, don't get me wrong, I still think the military, not necessarily the Army, but the military, all the services, including the Coast Guard, which a lot of people forget even exists,
sure,
can provide a young person with a great start in life. And what I mean by that is, depending on how you score on what they call the ASVAB aptitude test, mm-hmm. which may qualify you to work in intelligence or computers, or maybe you just have to be in the infantry, who knows? But, you know, that it gives you a great chance to travel, to be away from the family, to be on your own. I'd say sign up for 4 years. You know, there are some great college assistance programs, depending on the service and what skill you choose. Sign up for 4 years, try it out, get a little discipline in your life, learn a skill perhaps in electronics or computers or medicine or whatever it is that interests you. At least a lot of people at that age don't know really what they want to do. And you get out there and just be part of the world. And I think the great thing about it is that you get to meet people that you would never meet maybe in your little hometown in Maine, like where I grew up, for mm-hmm. example, and just have a chance to interact and try it out. Do your 4 years, see if you like it, maybe you won't, et cetera, et cetera. But just let me conclude by saying, you know, the military is not for everyone. In fact, if I were a king for a day or 4 years, and several Congress people have promoted this, is the concept of universal service for both men and women. And that is, we live in such a great country and yet we take it all for granted, that wouldn't it be nice that a person could do a year or two before or after college with some financial incentive from the government? And you could be a teacher's aide, you could be a medical orderly, there's, you know, just hundreds of different positions that where you could work for a small stipend, and then at the end of that 1 or 2 year period, get some college assistance or whatever it is you want. Because not everybody has the aptitude or the skills or the mentality or even the physical ability to be in the Army or the Marines, for example. And each of the services, I would also say, has a completely different corporate culture, if you will. A lot of young people don't understand that. They think the military is all the same, when in fact, each of the services is distinctly different.
Sure. So if a person, let's say a person doesn't take orders well, would you say that their personality might not fit well in the military? Or does boot camp, no matter how strong your personality is, does boot camp kind of remove that, break you down, rebuild you?
I would say yes and no. And once again, it depends on the service. The Marines certainly are like that. That's part of their ethos, is to teach people to do things, quote unquote, the Marine way. Mm-hmm. But I would say I was a person who, and that's one of the reasons I didn't go to West Point, was that I don't take orders well, mm-hmm. but you learn to go along and get along, if you will, right? Okay. And you also learn that, you know, as long as you're working for a good leader, a good superior, for example, they're not going to give you stupid orders, usually. I mean, in my career of 25 years, I was fortunate that I only had 2 or 3 guys I couldn't get along with. And the nice thing about that is, generally in the military, at least in the Army, you knew that within a year, either you could be gone or he could be gone or would be gone.
Right.
So you only had to put up with the idiots for a year or so, if you will. And let's face it, every organization has its share of village idiots.
Because if they didn't agree with you, they were automatically an idiot, right?
No, not necessarily. I'm just saying that.
I'm kidding.
I understand. We all have been there, though. You know what I'm talking about.
I think we all think that way. Right.
Yeah. It's interesting. I'm looking at both of you, and a clairvoyant and a colonel. I guess I'm automatically putting both of you in these different categories. What's it like to be married to a clairvoyant?
Well,
it's
different. I'll be honest with you. I was motoring along in life. I was previously married to a physician for 15 years or so. And she was married to medicine more to marriage than so forth. So mm-hmm. we eventually parted and we didn't have any children, unfortunately. And I was happy as a clam as a bachelor for 15 or 16 years. And then Mindy came into my life, and I was kind of, you know, being in the Army and being an Army colonel, I'm kind of a black and white kind of guy.
So, right. Okay.
So, and I will admit, we are complete opposites, even to this day. I'm very conservative, and I actually favor Fox News over the Huntington Post. But anyway, so we began to date, and I'm sure she will have some stories about how unusual our first date was, for example. And when I told some of my male friends that I was dating a clairvoyant, they said, "What? What's a clairvoyant?" So after I explained what that was, they said, "Buddy, you better run." But anyway, it worked out. So it's been, you know, we have issues like all couples do in a marriage, but it's been, 7 years now, I guess?
Yes, 7 years.
Still going on. So.
So for those that are listening and wondering just that, what's a clairvoyant? Mm-hmm. Melinda, share with everyone what it means to be clairvoyant.
Well, you know, Christina, I actually prefer to be called a medium than I do clairvoyant.
Because okay, Michelle, change the title of the show.
Because that's the bulk of my work is talking to what I call the other side. And, you certainly don't grow up thinking that you're going to talk to the dead for a living. And certainly when you've spent a career in the Army, you don't expect to marry someone that has been talking to the dead for a living. A clairvoyant is someone that's able to see, hear, feel into other worlds. It's, a general term for that. I'm actually more clairaudient. Clairvoyant means to see. Clairaudient means to hear. I was raised as a good little Catholic girl, so I thought that maybe I shouldn't see and just shut up and hear. So I'm clairaudient more than anything. But I'm well known in the United States as a medium and get calls from all over the country to talk to people that have crossed over. And the bulk of my practice is unfortunate people who have lost children. And it's not something that's easy to explain. I don't know why. A lot of times people say, "Well, why are you able to do that?" I don't know. I don't know why I'm able to do that. We talked about dogs a little earlier. A dog can hear a whistle that we can't hear. I can hear into the other side that other people can't hear. That's the best way of my explanation of it.
I don't know that. So does it mean that you can also know people, what people are thinking?
Sometimes there is.
See, I don't know that I'd want to be married to that.
That's what my friend said.
Well, I must tell you the story of one of our dates, because he was very skeptical, and he took me to the symphony. He's a music lover, and that was something I certainly appreciated about him. And we were about to have the show start, and I said to him, "What's your middle name, Alan or Alex?" And he said, "Well, how did you know that it began with the letter A?" I said, "Because my kids did a background check on you." And he said to me, "Well, if you're really clairvoyant, you'll get my middle name." And then, the production started. So I thought, well, heck. So I kind of tipped into his energy field a bit, and his middle name actually is Allison, and I got that, and we went up for a drink in intermission, and I said to him, "It's Allison," and he had a mouthful of wine, and he spit it out and said, "Oh my God, yes, it is." I said, "Well, this is Rumpelstiltskin, give me the name." And so that was one thing that happened that made him a believer.
That's unbelievable.
Yeah, that was pretty fun.
So how does that happen? Like how did you get that? Because if you hear things from the other side, or you sometimes can sense what people are thinking, did you receive that because that's what he was thinking, or someone from his life came and told you?
Well,
that was
his an excellent question, and again, I'm not sure of the answer. Because I received that information in some thought form, whether that was because his mother likes me and she is passed over and she thought I might be a good fit for him, or whether I, jumped into his brain and picked it out of his brain. I can't tell you, because it was a thought that dropped into my head.
Okay.
I do, when I'm doing readings, predict future fairly accurately. Remember that not even God can predict the future, because he gave us free will. But I've been doing this for 25 years, and people come back to me and, you know, tell me that what I've told them has come true. So therefore, I can't pick that out of their heads. Right. So it's a very hard thing to explain. You know, I'm not really one for Fruit Loops and wind chimers. I don't like the La La Land people. I don't like New Age doors. I don't like all that. What I think it's a crock of crap. So, you know, I'm pretty down
to earth. See, Michelle, I told you were going to love her.
I'm pretty down to earth.
I like that half of our audience is probably saying, this lady is Fruit Loops, which is like, I don't believe in those Fruit Loops things.
So, you know, that's why, Michelle, you know, that I don't know any one of us that have the ability to be able to tap in and get that energy can really explain it. I think if it, you know, it's really impossible to explain certain things in life anyway.
Sure. I just didn't know if there was a difference, like for someone like you that can hear and sense those things, if you can tell a difference of this is someone from the past that, you know, that has crossed over that's throwing this in my head, or is this someone who's currently here that I'm hearing their thoughts? I didn't know if that's something you
another can tell great, the difference. Another great question. When I, first of all, I don't use my abilities, if you want to call them that, in life, in my general life, like if you came up to me at a party and said, read me, I wouldn't do that. I do it for work. And when I'm working and I'm talking to someone from the other side, yes, I can tell that it's a voice from the other side and it has a different tonality or a different way of speaking. Each person from the other side still has a personality intact. So my clients will say, oh yes, that sounds just like something my mother would say, or, oh my goodness, that's a phrase that my father always used, that kind of thing. So when you're doing the work that way, Michelle, then yes, I know the difference between whether I'm just getting it as a quote unquote psychic thought or whether I'm doing medium work. But in an arena like sitting in the symphony and the thought drops into my head, I have no idea.
So you had shared that you do readings and people call you from all over the country.
Right.
So people can call you and you're able to just tap in over the phone?
Yes. Yes. I actually read off of photographs as well. And so people will email me some photographs and or mail them to me. A picture really captures somebody's essence. So I read off of photographs. Yeah, I get calls from all over the country, and I've gotten calls as far away as Hong Kong, Australia, Dubai, England, France. You know, I get a sprinkling throughout, you know, overseas as well. So Hawaii, yeah.
This has to make you really honest in your relationship. I mean, really honest. Like, if you're going out for drinks with the guys, you got to say, I'm going out for drinks with the guys.
I guess so.
Yeah.
It's not something I worry about that much.
So. Sure.
But you know, unlike you, Christina, I guess he's honest. You're so funny. You're like, boy, that would keep me honest.
Well, you know, just for your listeners to know, you know, my husband and I are in our 60s, so we don't have too many concerns about going out drinking with the guys at this stage of life. Our big Valentine plans are going to go see SpongeBob with our grandson. So
that's awesome. I actually want to see that movie. It looks really good.
But sometimes, you know, we just had an incident that was a serious incident with between us that happened with the clairvoyant stuff. And that is that I felt agitated one day and I was at lunch with my assistant and she said, you are so agitated. And I said, I know. And she said, why? I said, well, I don't know, but I'm going to go home. Now, my husband had not been feeling well for a day or two, but he's very strong-minded and he's very independent and he doesn't like to have a fuss made over him. And I was trying to convince him that perhaps he should check in with a doctor. But that particular day, I knew I had to go home and check on him. And when I got home, he was pale and shaking and I rushed him to the ER and he had a large pulmonary embolism. I had 5 clients that day in the afternoon and then I was going to go get my hair done. And if I had not trusted my intuition and gone home, I would have found him dead, basically, because you don't survive that kind of pulmonary embolism unless you get right to the hospital. So in our particular situation, their clairvoyance has actually saved my husband's life.
And it's interesting that when we were thinking about getting together years ago, I like to think or meditate on things. So when I was trying to meditate as to whether or not this is the woman I should marry or not, a voice came into my head, and you can call it God's wisdom or whoever you want, but the voice told me that you should marry this woman because she will save your life. And years later, it was proven true. So I guess I owe her one.
And that's the story of the Colonel and the Clairvoyant.
Okay, I don't know about you, but I just got chills over my entire body. That's unbelievable. So you guys are actually perfectly matched for each other.
You know, it's an opposites attract kind of thing. You know, when we were dating, he went down to Mexico with a friend of his, and he really didn't have a full idea of what I did at that time. And he called me and said, "I'm channeling you on the beach." And I thought, holy mackerel, who is this dude?
So is she rubbing off a little bit on you?
Yes.
You know, I came into his house, and there was this spirit in his house. And I know this sounds like, I know what it sounds like, but there was a spirit in this house. And I said to him, there's this dead guy that's running around your house. And he wears a red flannel shirt and suspenders. And he's around this house all the time. And my husband said, oh, yeah, that's my Uncle Edgar. So we've had Uncle Edgar living with us ever since I've been there, too.
This is really kind of an interesting story because growing up, I was not very close with my stepfather, who did not do the things that, you know, a father should do with little boys. And I kind of arrived as an accident into my parents' lives. My brother is 15 years older. My half-brother is 15 years older than I am. And my stepfather once called me, "Oh, you that mistake on a drunken Saturday night." So he and I were never close, but his brother, Edgar, the man Mindy just described, never had children, never married, went to college in the 30s. And then later, the story goes that some woman broke his heart, so he retreated into the woods. You know, I grew up in a small town in Maine and was a hunting and fishing person all my life. And it's basically because he taught me all these things. Mm-hmm. He took me under his wing. And I would have to say my uncle was much more my father than my stepfather was. He taught me how to read before I could go to kindergarten, how to hunt and fish and be independent and all that sort of stuff. And he and one other man were my two primary father figures growing up in life. So it's not unusual to me to think that his spirit spends a lot of time next to us in our house.
Sure. But the night before he had the embolism, I said to him, "Gosh, Uncle Edgar's really hanging around here. I wonder if that means you're crossing over."
You said that to him?
I did.
You said, "I wonder if you're crossing over."
Yes, I did, didn't I?
Yeah.
Okay, hold on a second.
We don't believe in death. We just believe that you move out of, it's like moving out of an apartment into a new house. We believe that you just move out of your body. So we, you know, when we talk about that around the house, and my husband has had other situations health-wise, so it just was a natural thing for me to say to him, "Gee, your Uncle Edgar's been here a lot today. I wonder if you're crossing over."
It feels like the way you just mentioned that was like, "I wonder if you're going to Circle K."
Yeah.
"I wonder if you're going on a trip."
Yeah. Well, you know, I've talked to the dead for 25 years. No one's ever told me it sucks over there.
So, okay, that's a great point. If no one's ever told you that sucks, does that mean that there's no heaven and hell? Or does it mean that the people that are in hell can't talk to you?
Well, my personal belief system is that hell is right here on earth. There's nowhere else, I think, in the universe where somebody can take a 9-year-old and rape and murder them, regardless of whether the fire department lets you burn the house down or not. So I think we actually live in hell, and I think our egos kind of fool us into believing this is a great place to be. And it's really just a place that we're learning and trying to figure things out. And I think that after we leave hell or earth, we all go to heaven, regardless of whether we've been victims or victimizers or whatever, that we still all go to what we would call a heaven place or a dimensional frequency where our souls kind of re-energize or regroup and figure out what's next.
Do you think that believing in something after this matters or not? Because I've heard some people have said, have the belief that if you don't believe in something after, then you will go nowhere.
Well, interestingly, I don't know if you're familiar with the book by, I think he's a neurologist. Was he a neurologist? Eben Alexander, that wrote a book. He was a neurologist at Harvard, and I cannot remember the name of the book off the top of my head. I just remember his name is Eben, E-B-A-N Alexander. And he had a near-death experience and always said, when you're brain dead, you're dead, and there's nothing after. And in his near-death experience, he was met by a beautiful woman who took him across and then said, you can't come, go back. He had been adopted, and because of the near-death experience, he decided that he would look up his biological family. And when he met someone from his biological family, the beautiful woman that took him across was a picture in that household. And he said, who is that? And they said, that would be your sister. So he became a believer, and so you ought to look him up, Eben Alexander. You know, all the books have the same kind of titles, Heaven is Real, or There Really is a Heaven, and all, you know, they all have a similar title, so I'm not sure which is his, but I don't think it matters whether you have a belief system or not. You still go to a different dimensional frequency, and I don't care what religion you practice, you still probably get to the same place.
The title of his book is Proof of Heaven.
Oh, thank you.
A Neurosurgeon's Near-Death Experience and Journey into the Afterlife. Oh,
there it is. Good. Thank you.
You're welcome.
How about a story?
I would love a story. Stories are great for the show.
Many of us, of course, have heard of people that have had near-death experiences and where their soul, if you will, or whatever, temporarily left their body. And for whatever reason, it was not that time, and they were returned back to their body. Well, here's a real story from when I was married to my previous wife, the doctor. She came home one day from the hospital and she said, boy, you know, we had a really interesting experience at the hospital today. And I said, really, what was that? And she said, we had a man die on the operating table and we worked on him to get him back. And we finally did get him back. And when he came to in intensive care, he told us the story of how he had temporarily risen above his body on the operating table, and then that he had actually risen outside the hospital and then hovered there for a while God was deciding if it was my time or not. And apparently he wasn't, because then the next thing I know, I went back into my body. Well, of course, we were all skeptical. And he says, oh, no, let me prove it to you. He said, while I was above the hospital, I happened to notice on the third floor on the west side of the hospital, there's a pair of sneakers that someone had put out on the windowsill. And we thought, oh, yeah, right. So we sent an orderly over to check on the west side, on the third floor. And sure enough, in one of the rooms, he found a sneaker sitting out on the windowsill. So there you go.
Is there any way he could have seen that when they were coming to the hospital?
I don't think so. It was on the third floor, probably, you know, up out of sight.
So. I think the father actually wrote the book, Heaven is for Real.
Right.
And he talks, the little boy had made a comment when he was being operated, or I can't remember the situation. But anyway, his mother, he was telling them that he had seen his mom crying, talking to someone on the phone, and his dad was somewhere else. So he explained that in his book, that something similar to the story that the Colonel just told us was like that.
Right. That's amazing. That's a good story. Okay, we're going to go to a quick break. When we come back, the phone lines will be open. So if you would like to call in and talk to Melinda Vail, you certainly can do that. So quick break. We'll be back in just a couple minutes. I'm Christina.
And I'm Michelle.
Hey, Christina.
We'll be back in a few. We'll be back in a few minutes, okay?
Okay.
Everyone's going to need an attorney at some point in life.
So
I'm no different. Hey, everyone, it's James from Vets On. whether it was my last will and testament before deployment or my ongoing custody battle for my children during my divorce. I needed help, so I lawyered up. If you need help, I urge you to contact Capstrom Law Firm. Capstrom Law Firm in Springfield, Missouri services clients throughout the state in criminal law, personal injury, and family law. With over 13 years practicing law, Tom Capstrom understands both law and court procedures and how stressful they can be. Let Tom Capstrom Law Firm and his dedicated staff take the stress and worry out of a difficult situation by calling him today. We feel so strong about the work that Tom and his staff are doing that he'll be a monthly guest on the show. Tom is a veteran and a listener, for God's sake, so you know the guy is solid and will fight for you. Give Tom a call today by calling 417-864-0552 or email Tom at capstromlaw.com. And don't forget to tell him that Vets On sent you.
The choice of a lawyer is an important decision and should not be based solely upon advertising.
Breaker, breaker, one nine. How about that bandit? You got some ears on, son?
Have you ever wanted to be a truck driver? If so, pay attention. If not, pay attention anyway. Southwest Truck Driver Training offers everything you need to get started. You can get hired before you begin training. They've got GI Bill approved training facilities, day, night, or weekend programs to fit your busy schedule. And if you have any questions, no sweat. They've got veteran supportive campuses with veterans on staff to serve you. And on top of that, they have lifetime job placement assistance. Put the pedal to the metal. Call Southwest Truck Driver Training today.
If you or someone you know is looking for a new job or career, you need to visit the pros. National Career Fairs at ncfairs.com. National Career Fairs hosts over 300 career fairs a year nationwide. The events are free and give you the perfect chance to meet some of the top employers in your area face-to-face. To find the nearest career fair to you, visit ncfairs.com. Again, that's ncfairs.com. What are you waiting for?
Would you like to own a thriving business and help employ local veterans? The Vetroplex Handyman Construction and Landscape Business is the opportunity you've been waiting for. The Vetroplex is your gateway to an affordable startup business with 0% financing for qualifying owners. By owning a Vetroplex franchise, you will be hiring veterans, providing them both income and opportunity, while at the same time providing your customers a way to say, thank you for your service to our nation's veterans. For more information, visit Vetroplex.org. Again, that's Vetroplex.org or call 928-284-2022.
You're listening to No Limits Radio Show on the Vets On Media Network.
All right. Welcome back to the show. We've got Melinda Vail. She is our clairvoyant, but she wants to be called a medium. So, and we have her husband, the Colonel, in studio with us. And I believe we have a caller on the line.
Yes, you do.
Hi. And this is?
Shane.
Hi, Shane. How are you?
Good. How are you doing?
Good. Thanks for calling in. All right, so
I'm calling in.
So, Melinda, how does this work? Does he ask you a question?
He asks me a question, or he asks the Colonel a question. I mean, it's not just me. I think that, you know, there could be some questions that somebody might want to ask the Colonel. So
absolutely.
Go for it, Shane.
Just any random question.
Any random question, Shane.
All right, how long away is love in my life?
It's as close as when you learn to love yourself, Shane, because you still have some childhood issues that you need to work through. Around 11, maybe fifth, sixth grade, and you still are holding on to an old relationship that's getting in your way. You know, yeah. You are deeply loved by lots of people around you. You know that, right, Shane?
Yeah.
Okay. And so you've got a lot of capability to have a lot of great love in your life. There's just something that I want to go back to with when your own little childhood there and something from the past that you need to clear, and then you'll pull love into your life.
Okay. And it's fair to say that there's definitely some accuracy there to that.
Well, thank you, Shane. I appreciate that confirmation.
She's now a confirmed medium.
And you know what else, Shane? I want to tell you something, Shane. I pick up something around your leg or your knee, Shane. Are you having trouble with a leg or a knee or a hip or a foot? Or what's wrong with your leg? Have you ever had a surgery on your knee? I'm sorry?
It's a little higher up. It's my back.
It's your back. Does it generate down into your leg, love?
Yes.
Okay. You know what? Acupuncture. Have you tried that?
Yes.
Okay. Is it work for you?
For about 10 minutes.
Ah, okay. Then again, you know, I want you to work through something with some childhood stuff, because when you have a physical ailment or injury, it always relates back to a thought process. And there's something about Virginia around you too, by the way. I don't know if that's a name or the state.
I've never lived there, so.
Anybody that you know named Virginia or Ginny?
No.
It's just so you know, Shane, I'm picking up that name around you, and you either think about it and or it's in your future then, since we're talking about some things. But I think that with your lower back and your back area, you still need to do some clearing, because back is always a reflection of what's back there.
Hmm.
Okie dokie.
Okay. And what about, do I have any unexpected moves coming up?
Well, you must expect something, or you wouldn't have asked the question that way, Shane. You know?
No. I'm not expecting any. I don't know if I need to be prepared.
No, Shane, right now it feels like at least for the next year or so, you're going to stay put where you are.
Okay, good.
Okay, Shane, thank you for calling.
I don't want it back again.
Happy Valentine's Day. Love yourself.
Thank you. Happy Valentine's Day.
Bye, Shane.
Thank you, Shane.
You know what's great about experiencing these conversations with Melinda, and I have personally experienced this before. When you go into her office and you sit down, she just starts jotting down all these names, and all these names are getting thrown at you, and you're like, what? I don't get it. And it can be a couple days, a couple months later, because you save those pieces of paper. So Shane, write down that name, stick it in on a post-it note somewhere, because that name will end up coming up in some way.
Yeah, it's interesting. I email from said James came to me, and I think Virginia is an older person's name, so you know, it's rare that somebody in Shane's age group, because he felt younger to me, would be named Virginia. However, the person that comes into his life may be from Virginia.
Okay.
That's why I said, is it the name or the state?
Sure. Huh.
So the Colonel, do you just get used to this? You know, is it just,
for the course?
It was interesting the first year or two as I, you know, spent more time with Mindy and came to understand what it was she did. And I will admit, even in the first year or so, I was pretty skeptical about what she did, because you read about these shysters all the time, right? So, but it was only until her administrative assistant was sick or ill for a period, a couple of weeks, I guess. I can't remember if that was our daughter or not. But anyway, I went in and was the secretary of the day, if you will, for a couple of weeks. And it was only during that period where I experienced people who came out of her office many times crying. And then, you know, she would take the next client and they would linger while they paid their fee and so forth. And they would say, you know, your wife is just so incredible. I don't know how she does that. And it was during that two-week period that my eyes were opened that, you know, I guess she really is the real deal. So, you know,
isn't he awesome? I mean, one of the reasons that I was so pleased about him was that he had no qualms about being Mr. Vail. I mean, Vail is my maiden name, and he has always backed me up. This is a man that's, you know, had lunch with presidents. So, you know, for him to have even come in and help me out that way is pretty awesome, let alone to, you know, let that be an experience that opened him more up. I think that's a pretty cool story, Colonel.
You have to tell a full story about lunch with President Reagan. It was me and 2,000 other guys. So, you know, it's not quite as intimate as you might
think. No, she's the wife. It was you and the president. That's
thank you,
way.
Michelle.
You're exactly. Welcome.
The point was he sat with a president and ate. That's the point.
I did get to meet President Reagan. And
what was that hand. Like?
He was extremely impressive. And I know, you know, I've known a lot of strong, capable leaders. But he was a tall man, well over 6 feet, and he had a strong grip and just, you know, those movie star good looks. But you could tell that he was interested. When he shook your hand, you know, he was like he was speaking to you, and a very self-effacing man. We were having dinner at a military association in Washington, D.C. Oddly enough, at the same hotel he was later shot at leaving. It was the year before that. And so as you may know, told a lot of jokes to people. And the press was way in the back on an elevated platform with the cameras and so forth. And he first took the first 10 minutes or so and just told a lot of Hollywood jokes and so on and so forth, basically to warm the crowd up, if you will. Mm-hmm. But then when it came time for his prepared remarks, he just said to the press, okay, we're done with that. And he took on a completely different, more official tone and launched into his prepared remarks. But I was part of a group of about 10 officers who were selected just to personally meet him. I was just very lucky and got to shake his hand and meet him. He was just a tremendous guy, tremendous, tremendous. I know not everyone agrees with that, but anyway.
Well, and what's interesting is that his wife was, Nancy Reagan, was very into astrology, the yes, stars, the other side, if you will. So that's another case of where, you know, opposites attract.
Right.
So
and Melinda's too modest to tell you this, but she speaks with a lot of celebrities and Hollywood types. And I don't know that there are any politicians she talks to, but I know that there are Hollywood stars, names you would know. But anyways, so.
But she probably can't share any of those names.
Or won't. But thank you, dear.
So the colonel had said, you know, there's a lot of people that aren't necessarily true to this calling that are out there.
Yeah.
I happen to love the show. Now why can't I think of it?
Long Island Medium.
Long Island Medium. So, yeah. And you don't have to tell me, or if you don't want to, whether you like or don't like.
I don't mind talking
like.
About her at all.
Okay.
Because she is the real deal. Her and Von Prague.
That's what I was going to
okay,
ask.
Her and James Von Prague. James Von Prague is the most generous man in this business. I have met and been speaking engagements with many people in this business, and you would be amazed at the ego that's involved. You know, I have a book that just came out a couple weeks ago called Morning Musings with Melinda, which is an inspirational book, but I am writing a book called Diary of a Mad Psychic, and I'm going to let it all out, man. I'm going to let it all out.
How awesome.
Because it's amazing to me the ego that you find in this business and how we've got people that aren't really walking the walk if they talk the talk. But as far as Long Island Medium is concerned, I think that Teresa is very genuine, very real. I don't agree with the show and I don't like what they're doing because A, they really are misleading the public. Everybody has a microphone on. It is not spontaneous. She's probably done 10 readings that day and they show the two best. That's, you know, how do I say this? Even on my worst day, I'm able to talk to the other side and satisfy somebody, but there are some readings that are just out of sight, depending on the connection between you and the other side. So they're going to show the best of the best for that one. And two, if you were a medium that walked around and randomly said, gee, your dead mother is talking to me, that would be a real boundary issue because, you know, you don't walk around and get in somebody's space. So you wouldn't just go up to somebody and start kissing them. That would be a boundary issue. Well, you don't just walk up to somebody and start talking to their dead sister. That's a boundary issue. So there are a couple things that I'm not happy about with the show, but it's not around Teresa. She's generous and she does a lot of charity events and doesn't take a fee, which is, you know, to me, what you're supposed to do when you're able to do this and that kind of thing. So Teresa's great. James Von Prague, awesome.
So I think it's interesting that you commented on the boundary issue there. Mm-hmm. It's kind of a social contract. Mm-hmm. Is that, you know, just like you wouldn't go up and just kiss someone that you don't know. So there's a social contract to not just be reading people at random.
Right.
Is it also a way of protecting you? Like, it would seem to me like if you were walking around the world and just had it
wide open.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It would seem like you'd be hit with a lot of stuff.
Yeah, that you're right. It would be kind of crazy to be wide open all the time. You'd obviously be getting all kinds of stuff in all kinds of ways. But it's a boundary issue and it is a form of protection for yourself.
So go ahead, Michelle.
No, I was just gonna say, but it could happen. So if you don't have up that boundary, you literally could walk down the street and sense things
people. Every once in a while, when I've had a little bit too much to drink, I turn into the Long Island medium.
Do you want a glass of wine?
I don't know. My girlfriend and I went to Mackinac Island a couple of years ago.
Michigan.
Yes, which is a beautiful, wonderful place to visit. And we were sitting at the bar drinking, and I think I'd had two. And the bartender came over, and I said to him, "Hey, Brian, can we..." Yeah. He said, "Well, how did you know my name was Brian?" He looked for his name tag, and I just knew his name was Brian. And then my girlfriend was like, "Well, but I don't usually do that, Michelle, but give me a drink or two and I might not be such a good girl. I don't know."
Well, alcohol does everything, something to everyone. Yours is just a little different than ours.
Yeah.
So is there anything about Michelle and I that while we've been doing the show that you've been picking up?
Oh, yes, absolutely. Michelle is a very, I've given you a reading before.
Yep.
Okay. So Michelle is a very interesting person because she looks like she's an extrovert. And she's very good with people, but she's actually an introvert. If Michelle doesn't get time to herself and by herself, she'll get agitated. So she needs some of that alone time. She doesn't get energy from other people. She gets energy from within herself. Then she gives energy to other people. That's why she gets up so early in the morning so that she can have some time to herself, because otherwise she'd go a little banana cookies.
She's very right with that, because if people get up before I have my coffee, I'm like, oh, like, it's just like, and it's not that my coffee is really that important. It really isn't. It's just like, oh man, I just wanted my coffee. I really just wanted my coffee.
That's interesting. So, yeah.
And now I will talk about the young man that's in the studio with us happens to be your young man, correct?
Yes.
What a perfect fit for you is this man. Okay. A very good man with a lot of integrity. Okay. A very deep thinking person and sensitive, much more so than he would let anybody recognize or realize. He's got a lot of deep sensitivity, right?
Yeah, you can try to deny it, but you're right. And, keep going.
So, and so that's a good fit for you because you're so sensitive, and that some of your sensitivity gets in your way. And his sensitivity is enough so that he can feel yours without allowing it to get in your way, and he can balance you or ground you a little bit or balance that out just a little bit. So you give him permission to be a little bit more free-spirited, and he grounds you a little bit. So there's a good mix there for you.
That is true. That is very true. Do you see him staying at his current job?
No.
Wow.
He wants to make some changes, yes?
Possibly.
Yeah, he wants to make some changes because there's parts of it that fit for him and parts of it that inhibit him from being the total package that he's able to be. So he'll stay in a learning curve, and then he'll make moves to do some more things.
That part's true.
Okay. Okay. He also has a break across his shoulder field. So I don't know, have you ever injured your shoulder or your arm?
A few years ago, I had tendonitis.
Yeah, just shows up in his shoulder when I look at his body real quick.
So what does that mean that he should do something about
I just see, there's an energy field around the body called an aura field. And I just happen to see people's field of energy. Michelle needs an upgrade on her glasses. His shoulder bothers him a little bit, that kind of thing. You know,
he's shaking his head. Yes.
You know, so you can see an energy field around the body called an aura field, and that just tells me if there's past, present, or potential health issues. And so when I'm giving a reading, I'll check somebody's health out. One of the first things I do is to look at the health field. Because actually it's very interesting. I had a woman that came to me and I said to her, you know, I give readings, I work long hours, I give lots of readings. I don't recollect people. I may meet them when I'm giving a speech, or they may have come to my classes or whatever they've done. And she sat down, I said, have I ever given you a reading before? And she said, yes, 2 years ago, and you saved my life. And I said, really, how did I do that? And she said, well, you told me I had a break in my breast area, and you said that I should go to the doctor, and that if you were wrong, that you would apologize, but if you were right, you might prevent something. She said, yeah, I had the beginning stages of breast cancer. So, you know, the aura can show a lot. Mm-hmm.
Well, I'm glad all she saw were my glasses,
right?
Yeah. Shit, that's an easy fix. My yes. glasses rolled, here I come.
So the aura shows a lot. The aura, can, you know, I mean, have you ever heard of that photography where they take a picture of your aura and that gives you a reading?
Mm-hmm.
Don't do that. It's a waste of money.
Really?
Yeah. Because if you get your picture taken with your aura and it's blue or it's green, and then you go out to your car and you listen to rap music or have a shot of tequila, or for some people, talk to your mother, you'll come back and your aura may be a different color.
Oh, that's
because
funny.
Your the color of your aura reflects where your mood is or at you know, what's moment. Happening at that moment.
Right.
Your aura is not consistent.
Kind of like those mood rings.
Correct.
That, I mean, it doesn't take much for it to shift
that's
in color.
Right. Yeah.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah.
Well, I accepted a new job.
Very good.
Yes. So do you see good things for that?
I think that your new job will be something that will give you some level of creativity that you haven't had before. Does that resonate
yes.
with you?
Yes.
When I look at it, it feels like it's an inspirational, creative kind of flow for you, and something that you've really needed, because you're very you're very creative. But sweetie, your creativity is your how do I say you're wonky.
Wonky? What's wonky. That mean?
Wonky. It means that her creativity sometimes shoots out in different directions, and she has to kind of rope it in and figure out what she's getting or what she's doing with it. Does that make
yeah.
sense? So she's wonky a little bit. So she's got to kind of sweep up some of that creative, because she can jump around a little bit and go, oh, this, oh, that, oh, wait, what, this, no, this. And so it lets her balance some of that energy so that she's, you know, focused and that creative flow and that energy. And she's also got a great left brain side of her too, though. I mean, that's why she's good on the radio. She's articulate. She thinks quick on her feet. She does a good job there. So it's not that I'm saying that she's flaky. I'm saying she's wonky. It's different.
Sure.
So, you know, she does balance with that left brain part of her as well. So, okay.
Excellent.
Right. There's something with the Southeast. Florida, Georgia, South Carolina, North Carolina. What's that energy? Alabama, Tennessee.
Did you say Florida?
Yeah.
My Aunt Cheryl lived there. She's passed away.
Oh, she wants to say hello to you. Okay. So there's energy from your Aunt Cheryl. And, you know, I wouldn't have your dad come in, because that would be a lot for you. I mean, I would have him come in anytime, but maybe, you know, not exactly on the radio. So, but anyways, Aunt Cheryl is just, I'm just seeing Florida energy around you. Okay.
Oh,
okay.
Crap.
She's going to cry for a second.
Okay. I'm totally ask crying. Me a question, Michelle.
I started a new job a month ago. What do you see about my job? I started about a month ago.
Let's see.
Well, let me take the glasses off, because that'll throw you off.
It doesn't throw me off at all. Can you write your birthday down for me, or do you mind
sure.
giving it to me on the air?
No, I don't care. It's April 16th.
Year?
72.
Oh, I have a kid your age, sweetie. Okay. Let's see. 4, 5, 11, 12, 21, 28, 29, 30. Oh, you're a 3. Okay, so that means you're a natural born teacher. Okay, also means you're a natural born actress.
Yes.
Yep. No, I'm just kidding. I'm really an actress.
So number threes are natural born teachers, and they're good in front of people. They're good in the public. They're able to, you know, present really well and so on. So just wanted to find out what your numerology was on that. Okay.
Okay.
Your new job feels to me like there's something more to come. Okay.
Okay.
That's the way I want to say it to you, that there's something more to come. It's a stepping stone in some form or fashion. Does that make sense to you?
Yep.
Okay. You have California energy in your energy field. Now, listen, we all have California energy in our energy field in Arizona. What one of us doesn't go to California? So, I mean, that sounds pretty stupid, but you have strong California energy in your energy field. So I don't know if you've ever lived there, if you're thinking about, you know, if you have relatives there, if you're thinking about moving there, but
if I could live there, I'd be there in a heartbeat.
Okay. All right. So maybe someday. Okay.
Yeah. Maybe someday.
All right.
What's this like on a daily basis? I mean, do you ever wake up and go, all right, so are you feeling like we should be going here? I mean, what's a day in the life?
Well, she works very hard and I'm retired. So she's up at 5 or 5:30 every morning and does some daily meditation and writes our Facebook message and so forth, and I'm still asleep.
when I leave the house, I start at 7 a.m. I have a first client at 7 a.m. in the morning. When I leave the house, he's still sleeping. And oftentimes when I get home, it's after 6 at night as well. So, you know, because our grandchild is 6, I choose to take 2 hours off in the middle of the day and go pick him up from kindergarten and spend 2 hours and then go back to work. So our schedules are very different. So oftentimes it's just normal. What was your day like, dear? And how are you? And do you want something to eat? Or did you eat? Or, you know, when are we going to get to go see Elliot, our grandchild? Or, you know, normal daily couple but stuff.
But go ahead. But let me ask you this, because I am, my significant other is military also. So I know that they're, you know, like you said, that black and white thing, and here's how it is. Right. But I wonder, now that you are in this life, are major decisions, when you want to make a major decision for the two of you, or even maybe yourself, do you find now that you do ask her opinion on this?
No, she's the general, I'm the private.
Oh, so you know to keep
happy wife, happy life.
But you bring up an honest point. I mean, we are very much opposite in many of our beliefs. She's liberal, I'm conservative. So we knock our heads about things. But
well, he's not as conservative as he leads you to believe.
Or as a label of an army colonel might believe. And you can talk about our family or not. I mean, if you want, and just how accepting I was of them. And the thing, the major thing I learned in the army, one of many major things, is that you take a person based on who they are and how they behave. You don't judge a person based on their sexual beliefs or the color of the skin.
That's
or
right.
You know, if they're Muslim or Catholic, it doesn't matter. You got to just, you know, take a person as they come.
See, at our core, at our very core, that's where we are so similar. When I had my first date with my husband, I said to him, are you prejudiced? And he said, well, I don't know. What do you mean? And I said, well, are you prejudiced against gays? He said, no. I said, are you prejudiced against tattoos and gauges and that kind of thing? No. Are you prejudiced against Mexicans? No. Are you prejudiced against black people? No. What is this all about? I said, well, I just want to know before I introduce you to my family, because I have all that in my family. And so, you know, he judges people by who they are and not what they are.
Are we going to music already?
Yeah.
Okay. I have one quick question.
One quick question.
We just had one of the biggest lotteries. Why don't people that can read into the other side, why don't they ever win the lottery, or do they? Is there social contract?
Not as far as I know. And I think that, again, that would be a situation where you would take advantage of being able to use that.
So it would be taking advantage of that gift. Okay. I knew there was a reason. All right. Great show. Thank you both for joining
Thank
us.
You.
Melinda Vail, share with everyone your website so that they can get a reading.
Melinda Vail at melindavail.com. Vail is spelled V-A-I-L, and you can Google me. I come up 1,000 ways on YouTube and so on.
She's also on Facebook, so awesome. Definitely check that out.
Thank you, Melinda.
Colonel, thank you so much for joining us.
You're quite welcome.
Thank you, Colonel.
All right, this has been No Limits Radio Show. If you like sports, stay tuned because JD's Rockin' Sports is up next. We've got a lot of great shows on the Vets On Media website, so be sure to check them out. We'll be back next week. I'm Christina.
And I'm Michelle.
All the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming. Get the rockets ready. The bomb was kicking in. Gave proof through the night that our flag was still there.